So yeah, I can see a lot of participants have logged in. Nice to see everyone. I'm going on mute right now. You tell me when to begin, and we'll begin soon.
Great, thanks so much, Tamanna. I guess we can start with our webinar for now. I will be briefly sensitizing all our participants today, post which we have Tamanna as our speaker who will be taking over this webinar. So first of all, as I begin, I would like to introduce myself. My name is Vidhi, and I'm from the Connect4 team, and I also have my colleague Mamta as well as Chirag from the Connect4 team. So feel free to reach out to either of us for any queries, and we will be able to help you. And on behalf of the entire Connect4 team, I thank all of you for tuning into this webinar. Basically, here is where we had planned and to sort of aspire to establish an effective post-lockdown work strategy for NGOs. So before I start, I would like to tell all the participants that you will be muted for the session. And if there's any question that you would like us to answer, you can share it on the chat option that is available to you. And again, we generously want to thank all of you guys for the work that you've been doing with COVID and all the resilience and passion that you have displayed towards ensuring the safety and welfare of all your beneficiaries. So it's really quite an inspiration to all of us. So thank you so much to all our NGO partners who have tuned in today. We are also really glad that we could also help you optimize the full use of Connect4 services. So as many of you know, Connect4 matches and connects volunteers to NGOs based on their needs. While the concept of monetary donation is quite well established in India, what we are trying to do is we're trying to empower people to donate their time and skill. For those of you who are new to Connect4, we are a digital volunteering platform with more than 350 NGO partners, and we have more than 19,000 volunteers registered on our platform today. So what we do is a simple match and connect. We match volunteers to NGOs based on whatever requirements they send us, and the service is completely free of cost. So we have a very simple registration procedure. So all the non-partners that have joined in today, please register your NGOs with us post this webinar. So currently, the way we're assisting our NGOs is through virtual volunteering. Then we have capacity building sessions for them, and we also share our content, digital content library, which is created by our volunteers actually. And they've created a lot of different material like learning aids for students, there are worksheets, there are audio stories, and a lot of other things. So, in case if you haven't gotten the chance to go through our content library, you can just go to our website and browse the same. Moving on to the webinar, why did we decide to host this webinar? While we all know this lockdown and the coronavirus crisis has affected the development sector and the NGO community thoroughly. So this has actually made some NGOs change their way of operations. While a question still remains for some NGOs in terms of how do they position themselves for growth in a time like this, and what are the most effective ways to plan goals and challenges and stuff like that. So that's why we got Tamanna today on board with us, who would be actually taking you through this webinar. I would like to introduce Tamanna. Tamanna is the founder and director at Umanshi Marketing that focuses on startups, small to medium businesses, and also the social sector. And they offer marketing solutions for them. Tamanna has more than 16 years of experience in this space, and she's also a volunteer with Connect4 for the past 2 years. So we're really happy to have Tamanna. And the sort of things that she's going to cover through this webinar is sort of going to be like, how do NGOs understand this whole new normal that has come into place? And how will they be able to plan their goals and challenges? And what are the other sort of tools and resources that would be available for growth? So before I hand this over to Tamanna, just very few simple instructions. So the session is going to be approximately 40 to 45 minutes. And post the session, we will have a Q&A. So you can actually save your questions for that. we will have the event run as smoothly as possible, and there might be a few technical glitches, but please cooperate with us, as you know your audiovisual experience depends upon how both of us, like both the speaker and the participants' internet connectivity issues depend on. I would also like to inform everybody that this is going to be a recorded session, and also my colleagues will list down the sort of things that you can do if you cannot hear or see us through the webinar. So please do not sort of spam the chat. Just reach out to us once and we will address it. We would also not like to hamper the experience for our other participants, so please try and avoid spamming the chat box. Also, please keep yourself on mute throughout the activity. And if you have any query, please message us. We will revert back to you instantly. Also, post the session, we will be sharing the feedback form. So I would request all of you to fill that, so you know it will eventually understand and help us improve our services better. So I would like to ask Tamanna to begin this session, and she can start sharing her insights with us. Over to you, Tamanna. Thanks so much.
Thank you. Vidhi, if you could let me share my screen, we can begin with the presentation right away.
You can start, Tamanna. Thanks. Okay. Thanks so much, everybody.
So yeah, is my screen visible to everyone, Vidhi?
It's not Tamanna.
Okay. Can you see the slide about myself? Me?
We cannot. Would you like me to demonstrate the presentation for you?
No, one second. I'll just quickly do it because.
We can see your screen now, Tamanna. Thanks so much.
Okay, great. Is the presentation visible now?
Hello.
Yes, Tamanna, you can.
Yeah, is the presentation? Okay. So thank you so much. I wouldn't take a lot of time in again introducing myself. Vidhi's done a fabulous job of introducing me. Straight away, starting with the presentation, we want to share that we don't have all the answers as we speak because of the uncertain situation and unprecedented situation that we face in, right? We can only gauge how things would be few months down the line or let's say even few weeks down the line when lockdown eases all the more in various parts of the country. How would people behave? We can only gauge, and therefore this is one of the thoughts behind the presentation that we put together, that we don't have all the answers. It is about understanding how things have progressed so far and how do they look in the near future. The presentation also gives direction and food for thought. It may not give you direct answers of exactly what's next thing that you need to do, but it is more directional in nature. In fact, many of these approaches or strategy or direction that we suggested when we were putting this presentation together, we realized is can be applicable even in a non-COVID scenario. It is just that at times it is adverse times or uncertain times that push us to adopt things which we've not been doing at a much faster rate. Yeah. We would be more than happy that after this half an hour or 40 minutes presentation, if you're able to take away even three key take-homes.
Tamanna, I believe you somehow have been muted. Can you please unmute yourself? Samantha?
Yeah.
We can hear you now.
Okay, what was the last sentence you all heard?
Tamanna, you were speaking about the key takeaways.
Yeah. For your social enterprise, for your NGO. I was saying that I've been fortunate that I work in social sector across and get to work with a spectrum of social enterprises or organizations in social sector. Some call themselves a social enterprise, some call them an NGO, some call them something else. And at the same time, there are various nomenclature or titles used for various things. Like example, in some places, you call people you interact with communities. You call people you interact with beneficiaries. Some call them customers, some call them recipients. So I, as I proceed, I would be using a mix of this titles and nomenclatures to address various people that I intend to address. Yeah. So COVID-19, the kind of challenges we have, suddenly on March 23rd, life came to a standstill. Everything was frozen. Exactly. People stood where they were. Our communities got dislocated. Our groundwork got disrupted. Over a period of time, we saw paucity of funds and uncertainty started looming across dimensions. So when I say across dimensions, neither did we know the dimension of funds. When will funds start coming in? What kind of funds will start coming in? Who will fund? Who stopped funding? When will it resume? When will operations resume? What time can one look at? So all these dimensions, we didn't have answer. In fact, we continue not to have answers to some of these dimensions yet. Like we know possibly the lockdown may get lifted or things may start opening up, but when would they come back to 100% normalcy? When would it be the same way that we were on 10th of March or 15th of March? We really don't have answers, and we continue not to have, or we continue to deal with these uncertainties. This is one of my favorite quotes, is that great leaders rejoice in adversity, just brave soldiers triumph in war. We all face adverse situations in our life, and this is one of them. We are in fact facing a pandemic of scale which the world hasn't really witnessed, humanitarian crisis that the world or the country hasn't witnessed, right? When I was going through the people who registered for this seminar, I realized a lot of senior management, trustees, founders, entrepreneurs had registered for the seminar. So when I mean leaders, I don't mean these people on the top. I also staff or the warrior on the ground who works with the communities. And this community, it is these communities, these beneficiaries who are now looking up to them. So how does each and every one across the chain, be it whether you're a trustee or a founder or a on-ground worker, how can you help these people come out of this uncertainty? How can you help even your enterprise, your social enterprise, your NGO, come out of the struggle that you are currently going through? It is a job of each and everyone across the chain. And why I say this is because many a times we as founders or senior management, we tend to hold the things or the challenges that we have very close to our heart. We don't really go out and speak to our people. So go out, get people involved, get them engaged, ask them for answers. For all you know, some wonderful answers may come from your team members that you wouldn't have or you may not have really thought of. These are the three strategic areas that the webinar would cover that we need to focus on. Okay, some of them have been picked up from the questions that some of you asked. Is a lot of you asked around fundraising. So that's where the first point came. And in fact, that was a deliberate attempt to keep it as a first point, is reimagining your revenue. Second is restoring your operations and then accelerating the adoption of digital solutions. Let's begin with reimagining the revenue. If you realize, the word reimagine has been used deliberately. Why? we need to reimagine things because the situation that we're facing right now is not the one anyone could have ever imagined. So the changes that we have to make can't be incremental changes, can't be changes which are very obvious. They have to be reimagined across the spectrum of work that we do. So first point under reimagining revenue, or our first suggestion for you, would be agility and innovation. How is this related to revenue? How is this related to fundraising? So things are not the same at the ground level. Several elements, including communities, stakeholders where you work, are disrupted. And so is your groundwork, is your organizational input, or sorry, output, that is disrupted. If you want things to come back to normal as fast as possible, then you need to handhold these communities, these beneficiaries, and help them come back to normal. If you are in education or sports or arts or skilling, you cannot conduct any of the earlier activities unless your beneficiary or his family or her family has had 2 square meals a day, right? So prioritize your customer, your beneficiary, your recipient over everything. Go back, understand where are they faltering, how else can you help them? So not only from the point of view that you need to get your operations back on track, but also from the point of view of funding. Medium-term focus of CSR funders is likely to be COVID-19. So it is important to think about what your NGO or social context. It would also be important to leverage your on-ground presence to learn more about the community needs, the new challenges, and how to solve for them. For instance, if you focus on building awareness for preventive healthcare in a community, you could address misinformation related to COVID-19 and provide actionable guidelines to the community. Similarly, if you are a skilling organization, you could work with your CSR funders to identify sectors for which the demand is likely to be high after the lockdown and start preparing for these. So yes, agility, innovation, thinking fast, changing the track of what you're doing, and relating it back to the present scenario of COVID-19 has 2-pronged benefits. One is from your customer or your beneficiary point of view, your community point of view, and second is donor point of view, fundraising point of view. This is important question, right? Kitne aadmi the? We all know that dialogue of Shole. How many sources of revenue do you have? Okay, where all do you do fundraising from? We typically have sources of fundraising, which is our CSR, retail donors, etc. But thankfully, we live in a new age or in an era or interesting times right now that gives us more opportunity for raising funds. What could they be? And these are something which didn't even exist possibly, or were not as rampant as they are today. So they possibly didn't exist 7 to 10 years ago. So examples are so many incubators, right? Incubators give you various kinds of help, not only incubate you, but also give you grants, they help you capacity build. If you are looking for a marketing expert or a legal compliance expert, they not only advise you who's the right person, at times they even bear the cost of the same. There are large philanthropic investment firms such as Omidyar, etc., which possibly it wasn't easy or out there, a decade ago. There are so many crowdfunding platforms, not only 2 or 3 that are there. Very important, I hear a lot of time, social enterprises or NGOs tell me that every time they appear or approach a corporate, the corporate already has NGOs who they are tied up with, right? So that's great. What about your own old sources? Have you thought of them? I come across NGOs or social enterprises which are almost 3 to 10 years old. In your or timeline of 3 to 10 years, you would have at least met 200 to 300 funders, donors, various stakeholders, partners. Do you have that database? Do you have a CRM in place? If you did a fabulous job of fundraising from Mr. X 2 years ago, and for some reason you've lost the touch with them, can you dig out your database and go back to them and request them to help you in these times? Maybe you would approach 1, 2, or 3. It may not work. Maybe it would start working from 4th, fifth or sixth onwards. But give it a try, because these are the people who already know about your NGO, who with whom you have possibly the credibility established. It is just for some reason that you've lost touch with them. Yeah, create flexible payment terms, make it easy, etc. I'll skip this right now and I'll cover it in the next few slides. How else can you do? Anjali is there. Anjali is the co-founder of PIFA. I worked with PIFA closely a couple of years ago, and that was again through Connect For. So PIFA does this fantastic work of helping backward strata of society in teaching and training them for sports. Now I'm sure, because nobody is really keen on sports, and we all are like under lockdown, if this activities come to a standstill. And similarly, you all need to think about your NGOs, how your NGO activity may have come to a standstill. So this is PIFA's website, but what PIFA didn't do is PIFA didn't really, or at least it didn't appear from the website. Sorry, Anjali, if you're there. It didn't really capitalize on the opportunity. How do you think PIFA could have capitalized on this opportunity by its own digital assets, or through its own digital asset, which is its website? Okay, so this is what THOA did. THOA is the House of Artisans. They work directly with rural artisans, and they get handicrafts and such other items made from them. Obviously, during lockdown, nobody was ordering handicraft, nobody was buying these items. But at the same time, on their website, they ran a campaign to help rural artisans and donate to their cause. PIFA also, I'm sure, would have continued to incur several expenses. Actually, many a times, brings down people from across the country to learn sports in Mumbai. It trains them, it provides them, for F&B, etc. So many expenses. These expenses could have been possibly covered if they could have done fundraising through their website, or made their website a payment gateway for fundraising. The other such example is Udyam Learning Foundation, that works with nano entrepreneurs. So what Udyam Learning Foundation does is that it works with Dhobi Walas, with the several chai walas, etc. And obviously during lockdown, these guys had almost no income source. So Udyam Vyapar raised donations for them. It put it out on their website, on its social media, etc. And you see this, they raised almost 10 lakhs rupees of fund. Yeah, for around 200 plus Vyaparis in Bangalore. So use your website, use these digital assets smartly, help your communities stay afloat. This is an interesting report by BCG. Now, next question that I get asked is that a lot of corporates are going through a bad phase. They have stopped their funding, they have reduced their funding. Who do we approach, etc.? What this report tells you, or tells one, is that in the coming time, where is the customer likely to spend? That means, see, if you see these greens, the customer is likely to spend on household care products, on DTH services, on various services. So that means these industries possibly would do better than other industries. If they do better than other industries and they have more funds, more revenue, that means possibly these are the ones that you need to, these are the corporates in those industries that you possibly need to target for your fundraising. Don't have a blanket approach. Think of the times that you're living in. Think of how companies are changing, evolving, and therefore who you need to approach and what should be your pitch to them. So that's how you can possibly shortlist who to approach. If you would have realized that the topic, or the first pillar that we suggested that you focus on, is reimagining revenue. It is not fundraising, right? Why? Is because we want you to not think fundraising. Think of your NGO or social enterprise income as revenue and not as funds, because fundraising is one of the sources of revenue generation. When you think of income in terms of revenue, your horizon broadens up. Also, it is important to think of revenue strategy, since many CSR funds have been diverted towards COVID. you cannot just depend on CSR all the time. Like going back to that slide, that how many sources of revenue do you have? At any given point of time, you should have at least 4 to 5 lines or sources of revenue or income coming in. So let's start with consulting as the first one. When a social enterprise has or NGO has in-depth knowledge or works very closely with a particular segment, it obviously tends to develop expertise in that segment. Now it is this expertise when you work at a ground level is something that many sought after. These many could be the private sector people, the government guys, or large philanthropy organizations. If you are in healthcare space for rural folks and a giant such as GE or Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation is looking for an expert to help them either reach out to these rural folks or develop a model for implementation, then possibly you could be consulting them. Right, and charging a fee. The next one is subscription. So now who doesn't love a free or a fixed income flowing in month on month without you being having to being on the treadmill all the time? So we all say isne fundraising kiya 2 lakhs, next month is 3 lakhs, last month we felt deficit of 1.5 lakhs, etc. But what if this income or this fundraising or revenue is automated? So how do we do that? Is that make it easy for donors to contribute to you. For example, if you're asking an HNI for a large fund upfront, instead ask them to contribute monthly, or instead of asking a common man or a middle class person pay 25,000 rupees or 50,000 rupees upfront, which may appear a large sum for the common man, ask him to, let's say, contribute to 3,000 rupees per month. Make it like an auto debit facility so that this revenue or this fund comes to you automatically every month without the person feeling a pinch of it. And secondly, the person or the donor feels associated with your NGO, with your social enterprise month on month. It doesn't become like one-time activity where the person's handed over 30,000-40,000 rupees to you and it's possibly door closed. Here you can be in touch with the person, develop your further contacts or circles from there on. Next, interesting, market access. So I'll give you an example of if an NGO or social enterprise A provides trainings to MNC employees for POSH, and if NGO B provides livelihood to women and they place their women workforce with various MNCs, then NGO A and NGO B can collaborate with each other to give each other market access to a wider base of prospective MNCs, right? NGO A would also have a database of all the HR people in MNCs. NGO B would also have database and reach of all the HR people in MNCs, right? So here is an overlap. Both the NGOs can collaborate with each other. You need to seek out who are the NGOs that are doing relevant work and or work with the similar donor set or target audience or community that you're looking for, and make easy or open up markets for each other. So this is called giving each other market access. The other revenue strategy you can adopt is selling your products and services. I'm sure many of you are doing it. Example I gave of Thoa, etc. But what about people who are completely not for profit and or don't have a product to sell, right? Then how do we go about it? Yes, it is going to be difficult over there, but at the same time, it is not impossible. So example, if you are an NGO,
Tamanna. Tamanna, you've got muted. If you can just unmute yourself.
Sorry.
Yeah. Sorry. No problem.
Is there a reason why I'm getting muted again and again?
I would request all the participants to only mute themselves and do not mute anybody else. If it is required, then we will mute them from our end. Yeah, I guess now it should not be a problem. Tamara, okay. If you can just mention the last point again. Sorry.
No problem. I should do that. So last point was about selling your products and services, right? Think of ways how you can sell your products and services, how you can enable your community to possibly create a product or service. It's not going to be easy for everyone. So example, for PIFA, which conducted sports activities, it conducted or created matches. It eventually had tickets put up for its matches, etc., and tried to get people. So I think that was a very smart thing to do. But for most of the NGOs, it may not be very easy to do it. Yes, this may be difficult. For example, an NGO which is educating kids in Dharavi, which is possibly running a night school. You got to think about it. What do you own that you can monetize? Possibly, do you own pedagogy? Do you own a unique way of teaching that you can monetize or teach other other schools in private sector and or various ways, or content that you've developed, you can sell it to other players who may be interested in the kind of content you've developed? Or can you put up some amazing videos on YouTube which may get monetized using YouTube? Yeah. The next point is about restoring operations. Yeah, many of you would have noted that it is not about resuming operations, but restoring operations. Of course, because you may not be able to resume exactly where you would have left. Hence, you need to restore, you need to rebuild. And the first point is transitioning into the work of future, the future of work. Yeah, communicate, collaborate, stay connected, have small lunches online. Life for a lot of us has shifted online, but don't come back all the time only talking about work. It is very important to keep your team motivated. Just have some half an hour, 45 minute sessions with your team members on random things like, what did they do last week? Was there a new movie? Did they watch? Did they binge watch a new web series? And how was it? How was the experience? So on and so forth. Avoid burnout in the sense that if a work, because we don't travel, when you're in office at 7 o'clock, we say, or 6:30, that it's, I'm done for the day. I need to leave office, and we continue with our next aspect of life, personal, social, etc. Right now, because we are at home, we continue to work. Be cognizant of the fact that 7 o'clock means ideally, or 6:30 means ideally, do not disturb your team members after work. It is very important that you take care of your team members, because that's one of the biggest capital you have right now. Last point, watch out, means when the lockdown relaxes, you may not want to call all your team members to office. Reason being, in case most of them get infected of COVID, God forbid, you don't want them to be suffering, and then eventually your work to get hampered. Yeah, if 90% or 70% of your workforce also gets infected, then the challenge is your work would also get hampered, be it your on-ground staff and or various other admin staff. So take turns in calling people, especially take care of people or women who've got kids at home, who are caregivers, who are pregnant, and or your staff who's possibly 60 plus, so on and so forth. They need to be taken care of. Also, one more thing is that watch out for people in your team who live alone. Yeah, it's been ages almost, or for them it's possibly decades when they possibly last had some human interaction. So make special efforts to reach out to them, to call them, to speak to them. You would have great operations on ground only if your core, which is your team, is strong, motivated and happy. It is important that you continue with a happy team. You cheer them, you recognize what you're doing, you recognize them in various ways. Yeah. Digitizing the value chain. So when I say digitizing the value chain, that means I'm sure you would have heard a lot of how to adopt the new normal. So this is one interesting thing that Udyam Vyapar did, is that their dhobi walas, the chai wala, etc., who were completely under lockdown, they still went ahead and conducted sessions online with them. Some of them found it very difficult initially to come online and to attend these activities, to listen to them, etc. But over a period of time, they did get engaged. And they did speak to Udyam staff about the challenges they're facing, etc. In that case, Udyam was in a better position to come up with solutions or the next step for their vyaparis and what all they can do. This is an interesting website that we came across, is that if I want to get connected with any kind of farmer or fresh produce across the country, all I have to do is just log on and I can see in which part of the country, wherever these dots are there, at what cost are they selling stuff, what's their contact number, etc. I can directly get in touch with the person. So someone's really ended up digitizing the entire value chain end-to-end. Similarly, in your operations areas, you need to figure out where do you digitize your operation value chain. Digitizing value chain is a topic in itself, so I'm not going to conclude with this. We have a whole section on going digital and how do you go digital, so we'll continue over there. But in restoring operations, you have to think digital. Yeah, so these are times resources are scarce, right? Everything is much lesser. Time is lesser, funds are lesser, uncertainties are more. Therefore, the situation has provided an opportunity to increase cooperation and streamline in the way social enterprises work. Earlier, inter-organizational meetings or stakeholder meetings would happen once in a month. These meetings in many social enterprises that I know happen once in a week, once in 10 days. That means information passes faster, actions are swifter. If you are at senior management level, have more meetings and meetings more often with your ground staff, your middle level staff, your junior level staff, because they ought to know what my management is thinking and ought to know much more. So share more information, collaborate. And when you do so, people are noticing that you can do things more efficiently when you coordinate and support each other. If you have various divisions and one division is stuck, maybe there is some other division in your organization who's doing work or has found out a way of doing it or solving that problem. So collaborate more. And when processes move faster, quick action is taken and action gets taken faster over the paperwork that is done. So less of paperwork. Anyone who comes up with a faster process, faster outcome, reward them. Reward processes, rewarding, eventually making sure it translates into action and rewarding that process is very important. Set up urgency goals. While it is nice to set up like 6 months, 1 year goal, etc., set up goals of actions or activities that need to be done every week, every fortnight. Okay, measure it, monitor it, evaluate it, assign responsibilities of who are the people in your organization who will be in charge of those urgency goals. Remember one thing, that people have power, people are smart, people are intelligent. Divide this power, democratize this power, empower them, let them run with a particular goal. And you will see when you share goals with people, they do wonders. They come back with some amazing stuff. So yeah, set up urgency goals and reward people for it. This one is my favorite. It is about creating your own ecosystem. I have realized that over a period of time, organizations which have collaborated with others, which have created ecosystem with others, tend to be more solid, tend to grow faster, tend to scale the solutions much more. Example, government machinery, private sector funds, or public sector, they are reach, they're mammoth in terms of reach, in terms of size, in terms of penetration, etc., right? So don't fight your battle alone. Join hands with them. This is Antarang Foundation, which does we worked with them last year. They're doing fantastic job in areas in and around Mumbai. They not only work with the municipality schools kids to or students to do career counseling, but they also get them placed. And so to do this career counseling, they've tied up with various government schools in and around New Mumbai, and which has given them scale, which has given them access to huge number of students in possibly one go. I'm sure they didn't start with thousands of kids. They would have started or done a pilot, etc. But eventually, today they can boast of transforming or impacting 82,000 youth or life. So you need to ask, who can you tie up with? How can you help? Reach out more beneficiary who has the common system or common community or common goals or shared goals, and therefore who can you collaborate with? You have to create your own ecosystem. How do you do this, right? So so even when government reached out to NGOs and a lot of NGOs pivoted, they immediately got into food distribution to be done. It while the regular operations were frozen, they formed or they came across a new set of operations that they could do and sustain their operations or sustain themselves on an ongoing basis. So look out or watch out for these activities. IDFC Bank did. Obviously, it couldn't have done only with itself. It partnered with Collective Good Foundation to do it. Again, Antarang Foundation partnered with IDFC Bank to create masks. Now, as I said, if you remember this slide, Antarang Foundation actually works with students of municipal schools and not only does career counseling for them, it also gets them placed with various corporates, etc. Now, when hiring was frozen, this is excellent thing that Antarang Foundation did. It went got into making these masks, etc. And these masks were created by its students who could not get placed, and they earned a livelihood out of it. So figure out, create an ecosystem, see how who you can tie up with, who you can collaborate with to get your activities or operations running. Rethinking delivery. Now, this is important. Your delivery, and this is actually the need of the hour. How will you deliver your program while maintaining a social distancing norm? If your community you're working with becomes a hotspot, how will you continue to support it? How can you leverage digital communication tools? So rethink your entire delivery. Life may not become normal as soon as lockdown opens up, but the time is to rethink delivery. I really like what Ajikay did. They didn't really create an app because 60 plus, it becomes very difficult to explain them to download an app, go to Google Play Store, figure out how an app works. But they are very, they are hands-on on WhatsApp. So they kept in touch, conducted activities, etc. on WhatsApp for them. Accelerating the adoption of digital solutions. We all have been hearing this since quite some time, the new normal, etc. And at the same time, it's just not enough, right? That we've heard of it. Should we have gone digital? Yes, we should have gone digital really long ago. Or more digital? Yes, there is. But it is that COVID, we've been forced to think digital. We've been forced to go more digital. But how does one go digital? What are the avenues of going digital is the question. I believe going digital and using technology helps NGOs scale faster. Right? You are any which way is constrained with resources. If you use tech, you can use tech to in a way that the same tech does the job of, let's say, 10, 20 or 30 ground staff. That same tech can keep track of what's happening. That same tech can communicate and be in touch with more people on the ground at the same time, right? So it helps you do more, it makes you more efficient. Technology helps you do that. Technology also helps you scale. You can use the same tech solutions that you've created for your community and replicate it in communities elsewhere also. So it helps you replicate your solutions in easier, faster way. So this is one interesting solution begins within. It is inside out. It isn't about having those meetings online on Zoom, etc. That's about it. No, it is also about you thinking digital first. So this is about La Charitable Trust, which is in Dharamshala. So this Tibetan organization and institute has not left any digital media option untried. Yeah, they can give any digital marketeer run for his or her money. Imagine being in Dharamshala, you're practically away or in some sense disconnected with the world. Being in a metro in Mumbai, to a government office, tell them our story, walk up to a CSR founder and or engage. But imagine they being in Dharamshala, it is so difficult. So therefore, they have used digital as their digital presence as their strength. In fact, not only their website and other digital assets, contact. They raise funds online from across the world. They reach out to diaspora through a Tibetan language website and share various information about their updates, about communities, about environmental issues within Tibet. They have a YouTube channel with hundreds of videos and they regularly post this video. The videos are very widely watched. If you would have seen this video, it has around 5,000 views, something even corporates would want for their video. They also have an online fair trade shop of the items produced by exiled Tibetan producers to support their livelihood. I just love that point. Because go back to that initial point, reimagining revenue, where the strategy for your revenue is one of them being selling products and services, right? So this is the way they have even started producing goods and converted their website into an online marketplace, which is excellent. So this is about being inside out. Go out, put up stuff about yourself, be regularly in touch with people. In many social enterprises and NGOs, I still see interns managing social media, right? If the intern has quit, the social media password goes away with the intern. I know it is difficult. I know that, you don't have resources dedicated like large corporations have one team only for marketing. You don't have that. But at the same time, the moment your digital presence starts becoming your priority or starts featuring in your important list of reaching out to people, being in touch with your funders, donors, creating awareness, automatically these things would be looked upon in a different light by you. So you have to ask yourself, what is your social media objective? What work does your website do for you? How are you helping? Is your website helping you generate funds? Is your website helping you raise revenues? Is your website or social media helping you be in touch with your communities? What is it that you are digitally present or your digital asset, what are they helping you do? Adoption of digital solutions in operations. I came across this Solace app story recently online. So, and I read someone's quote online. This is an app created by a company called Solace. So it's, I think, based out of Bombay. And where the quote of the person said, his name was Shamrao Vittal, working in Latur district of Maharashtra. He said they used this app Solace in digitizing their operations during COVID period. So what he said that they were working with many self-help groups to facilitate employment, education, food distribution, handing over or delivering grocery items door to door. And they were given this app where they were recording the beneficiary information and their photos as they received the relief materials. So not only that, the app also had geotagging and time stamping options. So what happened was, not only was the management really able to control or see what's happening on ground, the donors were also assured that their contribution to the cause is reaching to the right people, is being utilized in the correct way. So that is how the app was very helpful. So you have to think not only in terms of outreach or being in social media or putting up videos, how do you digitize your various aspects of organization? So this was one, operations. What I would like to understand suggest is, when you go about digitizing your organization, try and use value chain mapping approach. What is this approach? Let's begin with value chain. Many of us, this is a very simple diagram of value chain, really simplified. Yes, it can get really complex also. So, but the key actors or stakeholders in this diagram are donors, sourcing, where we source from, distribution or implementation, or our recipient, our communities, your beneficiaries, etc. But what we really miss out, and I would like you to start adding, is the recipient's universe. Understanding where the recipient comes from. Understanding how important is it or beneficial it may be for him to go digital or not go digital. Because if your beneficiary, because if you are ready to go digital and your beneficiary and your community or ecosystem isn't, then that's a problem. So go in depth and understand, is your recipient ready to go digital or not? If not, then why? Anyways, we belong to an era where millions of users, even from rural background, are coming online. On one hand, thanks to proliferation of smartphones or even feature phones for that matter. And on the other hand, connectivity is getting better with better internet penetration, with the better, cheaper packages that are available for internet, for data, for mobile, so on and so forth. Right? So how do you go about creating digital or accelerating a digital solution or a digital methodology for your organization? Start with value chain approach. What is a value chain approach? Value chain approach is first understanding what your value chain looks like. Okay, who are the actors or stakeholders across your value chain? Draw a map of that. What kind of activities take place along this value chain? Your operational activity, your financial activity, communication, any and every kind of activity that takes place across this value chain that's there amongst these stakeholders. Map these above two, the stakeholder mapping along with the activity that takes place, right? Then get into how do you digitize it and what are the factors impacting digital adoption. It could be propensity to digitize, importance or value of that activity for that actor, so on and so forth. So many things that could impact your digital adoption. So think of digital adoption or digitization from the point of view or of the recipient's universe. Map your entire value chain and think, where can you add value or how can you slowly digitize the entire value chain? To explain this better, I'm going to pick up one of the activities across one value chain. So if you see over here, there are operational activities, financial and communication activities going on across value chain. So let me give an example of a value chain, which is a dairy value chain, right? And all the activities that are going on in the value chain. We have created a map over here, which is of various actors, right? There are suppliers, there are financial institutions, corporate dairies, there are collection agents, rural, retail, so on and so forth. Various activities go on across the players of value chain. They communicate with each other, they make payments, there are processes going on, operations, so on and so forth. This mapping is specifically for financial transaction. Okay, so if you see the financial transaction that's been mapped, these are assessed on the type of transaction, frequency of transaction, value of transaction, across various interactions and stakeholders. The map also highlights specific challenges in a given segment. The assessment of financial transaction then helps us understand the status quo of each level of player. And when we know what challenges that each player faces or what's what is that thing which is a barrier in adopting the digitization, is then we go ahead and work towards it and slowly form pilot for them to go ahead and experience digitization in financial space. So this is what we did. We first drew a map of all the actors, all the players, right? We mapped one particular activity that goes on. This is financial activity. And then we tried to think that what would make them move from offline to online? What would help them digital adoption of this financial process or planning that happens? So mapping this activity. I picked this up from one of the IntelliCap reports. This is beautifully done. I think you should also go ahead and have a look at the report. It's a lovely report. Another thing that we get asked is, Hamara beneficiary is not online, our beneficiaries are difficult to teach all of this, etc. So the point is, beneficiaries are online, but, right, what are understand the media habits of the beneficiary. Understand what are the tools that can come handy for digitization. So the easiest tool is mobile phone, correct? So understand what do they do on mobile phones and then work backwards to get them what you want them to do on their mobile phones. How do you make them digital? See, remember one thing, not only them, but people like you and me are also averse to change. When you tell anything to people that needs to change, the first thing that kicks in is fear. And tech is something that adds to the fear in many, many, many ways, right? So one has to go slow, one has to understand their ecosystem, what is it they are doing, and then accordingly, go digital. So I would like to summarize over here is what happened is the usage of mobile phones by women dairy farmers and collection agents to a non-transactional basic use cases such as making and receiving calls or messages or listening or taking pictures and assessing social media. Therefore, it's SMS or calls. So how do you use this media to make them go digital, right? Also realize one thing, so this is the, I would suggest that you read this report. It is available online, Digitizing Rural Value Chains in India. It really provides a great approach and a framework for going digital. Though this was done for women's economic empowerment, it is the basic outline of the framework that they've shared is pretty much applicable to any line or segment that you're working on. Also realize one thing, that there is no such thing as technological panacea. There are a host of initiatives on the table. Koi kuch digital kar raha hai, someone is doing something else, someone is doing something else, and you don't know which to choose, where to begin. So where to begin? Simple answer, begin with your business goal or your organizational goal or a challenge or a problem that you're trying to solve for. There is no right or wrong answer. What has worked for NGO A may not work with NGO B. What has worked for B may not work for D, so on and so forth. You have to try and experiment and continue your journey of digitization. Some experiments fail, but obviously some will eventually work. So example, this is NGO in Bangalore who was working with LGBTQ community, and they would conduct classes for them online. Initially it failed. Nobody came online. One or two people came online. They were not interested. They wouldn't engage, etc. They would drop out. They tried different ways. It didn't really work. They were pretty upset. Eventually one of them came up with an idea of, what about if we form 4 to 5 member WhatsApp group? In that sense, it would be easier to control and engage with the participants, keep their interest levels high. This one thought, and it worked, and now they're doing really well. They have multiple sessions every day across various communities, across the geographies that they are working in. We are almost done with the presentation, and I see we have overshot the time by 10 minutes or so. This is interesting map that I came, to-do list that I came across is what not to do. Is of these, one of the important things is please do not stop fundraising or thinking of revenue resources. Go ahead, meet people, go ahead, appeal, don't stop communicating, don't stop not talking to people. Please revamp the way you communicate. You all think a lot, you all work very closely with these communities, beneficiaries. You know the ground level. You guys have so many stories to tell, and the world is waiting out there. The world is not connected with these people like the way you are. So you are a rich repository of the stories that are happening on ground, of the work that is done on ground. And people like us are dependent on you to tell us what's happening on ground. Media is dependent on you guys to tell us what's happening on ground. So go ahead and tell the stories. Don't use old email formats, etc. Don't lose hope. And of course, this section was what to do. Be creative, be innovative, go out, tell your story, keep reaching out to more and more people, figure out different ways of appeal, see what appeal is working to what segment of audience, re-appeal with a different format, etc. If one has not worked, you never know what may work some other time. Diversify fundraising avenues, I would really say that. Fundraising avenues, revenues, however you want to look at, diversify it. Don't really think fundraising all the time. Don't keep going to the same set of people. Look at different set of people. Look at different revenue streams that can be worked upon. Some parting tips is keep informed. Keep communicating, be it through social media, be it through WhatsApp links, write blogs or some videos that you want to put up on your social media or your website. Share challenges. None of us are superheroes. I get stuck so many times. I have mentors, I have my circles, and there are people who I reach out to saying, I don't know, nothing seems to be moving. What do I do? I'm stuck over here. Don't be shy in actively seeking support. It is never that people, in case there are few people who may not be able to help you, there are many more people who are more than happy to help you. And you may not know, where the next set of help can come from. Co-learn with peers locally, globally. Even though we work or come across or we do consulting assignments or we are experts in what we do, we still learn so much from you all. Because the kind of work that you're doing in your domain, right? So imagine you all have your peer group or other NGOs, other social enterprises. Learn from each other, understand what has worked for them, how are they doing it, collaborate with them. I would really request this again and again, is don't try and start everything don't try and reinvent the wheel. Don't try to do everything from scratch. I'm sure there are other NGOs or social enterprises who are already doing a lot of work in that particular sector or domain. Handhold them and or work with them very closely so as to get get going faster and have easy access and scale things. This is the summary, and with this we end the presentation. Reimagine revenue. Don't look at it as fundraising. Look at it as a revenue model. Ask how many revenue models or revenue streams that your organization has. Restore operations. Think about delivery. Think about how things would change now. Accelerate digital adoption. Use the value chain method. That value chain method has really helped us a lot. Map who are the important stakeholders, and more than that, don't end your digital adoption only up to the beneficiary level. Okay, think about his universe, think about his ecosystem. One small tip that I would like to give is what worked for us or works for us is every time we draw a map of people or map of a process, it really helps us. And then we start writing challenges. Lot of times we don't write challenges, we write solutions. To various things. When we write challenges is when our brain actively starts working on those problems or things. So write about challenges, write about or put those maps out there. Maps, map making technique is something interesting, not only for digital adoption. I would suggest for any other aspect of your operations and overall activity that you're doing for your social enterprise. Yeah, with this we come to an end, and over to Vidhi for next step and Q&A. Vidhi?
Yeah. Thanks. Thank you so much, Tamanna, for your wonderful insights. I think this is sort of going to be like a game changer for a lot of our participants today, hopefully. And we would really like to thank you for, you know, being such a wonderful and gracious host and taking us through this webinar. And I think it was really smooth as well. So I guess what we would like to commence with is anybody who has questions, we will take, I mean, looking at the time constraints, like we will only address 3 questions. And in case if you all have any other questions, we will address it later in our feedback form. And then we will send them to Tamanna, who will sort of consolidate them and get back to you. So yeah, if we can have the questions, please. So, Tamanna, we have a question from Pranav, who says that how does the mechanism of issuing donation receipts to the donors through online platform like email works?
So, this is very simple, Pranav. Is that when someone registers or makes a donation, you ask for various details, contact details, right? Their email ID, their contact number, address, etc., whatever you would want for your records. An email and few things are a must. An automated receipt goes out to them within, I don't know, that depends on the CRM and how you want to do it. Once the donation comes in, it can go out to them immediately or within 48 hours to them. So that can be automated.
Okay. Does anyone have any more questions? We will be happy to address 2 more questions and then we can sum up the webinar for today. So if anybody has any more questions, we have a question from Sagar, which is, would you recommend any CRM covering all processes for NGOs?
This is a tough one, Sagar, but I'm very happy that you've already started thinking in terms of CRM. It's a great move. It's a great initiative to put all your repository in one place, especially with people also moving in and out of organizations. The contacts or the relationships are there in their diary or on their phone. They also move out of the organization. You don't really own those relationships. So yes, CRM comes very handy. If there is one particular CRM, no, not really, I would recommend, but there are... I'll tell you why we can't recommend one CRM, because every CRM, while it is standard, there are also a lot of customizations that are required. So of the old or the traditional ones, Salesforce is supposed to be one of the best ones. I've worked on Salesforce, SAP and Microsoft Dynamics, a plethora of them myself. From the new age ones, there is Zoho, Freshdesk, so on and so forth. What I would suggest is, you reach out to the rep of these CRMs, ask them, give them your brief and requirement, and let them make a presentation to you of how the CRM can help you solve for your business challenges or help achieve organizational goals, and then decide for which CRM to go ahead. Personally, I don't have a favorite. If this helps, yeah.
Great. Does anybody else have any other questions? I think one minor question, Tamanna, was there was an NGO working for the artisans, which was mentioned in your PPT. Can you just mention the name, please?
Thoa.
Thoa. I'll just put it on.
Yeah. Thoa. Thoa is the House of Artisans.
Okay, so if does anybody else have any more questions? So I think what we can do is we can end this meeting here. So I would like to briefly wrap this up and thank you all for attending this session. I feel it would be great if you can all share your feedback with us. It has already been shared with you. So it would be great if you can fill the feedback form out and let us know what you thought of the webinar. I've also put down the link to our next webinar, which is going to be on virtual volunteer management, which we are doing in collaboration with UN volunteers. So I think this is something that if you're looking to seek virtual volunteers or you are working with virtual volunteers, this will be a great session for you guys. Also, in case if any of you all come up with more questions, feel free to reach out to us. We will convey that to Tamanna and she can consolidate them and get back to us. So, yeah. And all those new participants that we have today, new NGOs, please reach out to us on ops@connectfor.org. So you can partner with us as an NGO and we will be able to help you with various of our service offerings. All right, I would like to end this session on a great note. Thank you so much and being with us for 15 minutes beyond the session time. We really appreciate it. And please feel free to reach out to us in case if you want to know more about the session or upcoming sessions, stuff like that. All right, thank you so much. Thank you, everybody, for joining in.
Thank you.
Thank you.